Thank you very much for the presentation, and it's a pleasure to speak here. But in a sense, it should be some disappointing for the, how to say, frequent people who frequent this seminar in this room during the previous years, because it is, in a sense, déjà vu, ce que je, what I will speak about. It is a so-called dilation completeness problem. So the problem of completeness of the dilations of a function. So there is a function f on somewhere on the real line or on some interval, and you consider the dilation where n, or the continuous dilation ftx, where t, say, positive or bigger than one, and so on. But so the Riemann hypothesis will be in the margin of this lectures, and in principle this is the about zeta function and approximations. This is more precise title. So I'd like to prevent you that I'm not expert in zeta function. You may be, yes, so there is somebody who does not know the definition of zeta function? No, so you are experts. And so neither approximation, especially in the presence of Sasha Borishev or Misha Sodin, if he is here in Tatar. But however, I am an expert of something, and it is exactly this links. It is the usual joke in such kind of presentation. So the main subject is exactly here. So the links, the relations between zeta function, in particular Riemann hypothesis, and approximation. So let me start, however, even if everybody knows the definition, that the zeta function, starting from the time of Riemann, is denoted by Greek letter zeta, and but is defined not by Riemann. It was defined 100 years before. You mean that it should be?
Yes, it should be. Uh-huh.
Higher, like this, huh? But so I can use a half of this blackboard, yeah? Okay. Okay, for the complex S, Euler in the middle of 18th century regarded it for the real S, but however proved the principal functional equation for zeta. And so Riemann gave the zeta function the real scale and real value. So this is the entire function, excepting the pole, the simple pole at the point one of the residue one. And the problem, and for number theory, it is that it is, as you know, you are expert, huh? So it is related to the distribution of prime numbers, and for many subtleties of around this important problem. And the main objective here is the zeros of this function. So the zeta s is equal to zero. By the way, I highly recommend you how to say the popular book in Penguin editors in London, which is called Dr. Riemann's Zero. It's very, very nice written. I mean, not only on this function and the conjecture, the hypothesis, but around, so about mathematicians. So there is some trivial zeros, so-called, which is, so it is defined only in this half plane, but after a very little force, it can be extended holomorphically to the whole complex plane except this point s equal to 1, and so there are so-called trivial zero, and the Riemann hypothesis, which is so important for consequences in number theory, is that all other zeros, say real part positive, and zeta s equal to zero implies that s has the one half real part. So I will use very strange notation, which is so traditional that I cannot, regard it from some rational point of view. Because in this theory, the complex number S has the real part sigma and the imaginary part T. So from different alphabets. I will use these notations. Okay. So, what are the links of this question and the zeta function itself with the approximations? Approximations mean approximation by some kind of special functions to other functions or all functions in some space, like LP or weighted LP on the real line or on some interval. And the first example, I can say that there is many other representation for zeta, in particular integral representations. It started with Euler and then continued with Riemann. And Wolfram .com contains about 30 integral formulas for zeta. If you will consider other sites like American Institute for Mathematics in Palo Alto, you can find certain another formula, integral formula, and there is much more. I don't know the exact. So the first one links between this question and was done. So, where is the dilation completeness problem? It will be the next time in Wednesday, and in the second and third lectures today. I will speak only about the motivation, why this dilation completeness problem is important and interesting. Exactly in view of this end, because it is related to the theory of zeta function. So Norbert Wiener, in his famous paper of 32 in Annals of Mathematics, where he proved the Wiener-Tauberian theorem. Consider the following. Choose some integral representation, and this representation is here. I will prove his theorem because it is absolutely obvious if we accept Wiener-Tauberian theorem, which is now so classical. That so the representation is the following. All this representation which I will use, not so special as in Wolfram web page or other, can be found in Titchener's classical book, The Theory of Zeta Function, maybe of Riemann Zeta Function. So it preceded the Wiener paper, and still very informative, very interesting. So it is x over e to the x minus 1 minus 1, and the combination which we will see many times. So sigma is the real part of S, always. And so Riemann Wiener make the change of variables into y, and then they integrate by parts. So I will omit, no problem to make this computations, and arrive it in the formula. Gamma is the Euler gamma function. So the Millin transform of the e to the power minus t. 1 minus s gamma s integral over r, because of this change of variable. And after integration by parts, the derivative e to the e to y minus 1 e to the y s minus 1 dy. And so using s equal to this notation, so we get that 1 minus s gamma s is equal to integral e to the y sigma minus 1, the derivative of this strange function, and e to the minus e t y dy. Okay, so it's very easy to see that for this sigma, this function is in L1 of R, and so Wiener was ready to apply his Tauberian theorem, which says that a Fourier transform, which is here, the Fourier transform of this function, does not vanish nowhere if and only if the translation of the functions up. The problem is in up. Okay. And here also it is also.
It will be better if you will start first to write on Z blackboard.
Maybe. Thank you for a rational suggestion.
I'm sorry. There is problem with minus plus here. Yes.
Maybe plus. Plus, yes, yeah, there is. But doesn't matter. Huh? Yes. So the Wiener-Tauberian theorem says that if capital F sigma is in L1 and the Fourier transform of F sigma of T does not vanish for every T, then it is if and only if the span, so the closed linear Hall in the space L1 of all translations tau lambda of F sigma lambda belong to R is L1. Tau lambda is a translation, so tau lambda f of x is f of x minus lambda. And so we are done. So we obtained from this formula that zeta sigma plus it does not vanish for every given a sigma here, for every t on this vertical line. So we are here. This is sigma between 0 and 1, so it does not vanish in this vertical line if and only if we have this approximation here. So any function can be approximated by a linear, finite linear combination of this. Okay, so it's very easy, and even after the Wiener-Tauberian theorem, for free, the result. The second is the same, but it changed a little bit the integration space, and so I will give it. It was done by Salem in 1953.
Yeah. The closure of the span.
Yeah. Span is always closed linear Hall. Okay. So we make linear combinations and close. For linear Hall, I will use another notation. Okay. So he used another formula, gamma s 1 minus 2 to the s zeta of s, also can be found in Titchmarsh. It is the what I will use often, the Millian transform f, so the Fourier transform for the multiplicative group of positive numbers s, where f star of little f of s is 1 over 2 pi integral 0 f x x to the s dx over x. So this is the Fourier transform for the multiplicative group of positives with the invariant measure dx over x. And so so he used this integral representation, and he take in the similar method, but using, of course, not translations, because what is the translation here? The translation here is the dilations, exactly. D lambda fx is equal to f lambda x lambda positive. This is the translations on R plus. Consider it as a multiplicative group. And so, but the theorem is still the same. Wiener-Tauberian theorem works for almost all locally compact abelian group, and in particular here. And so we obtain in this, by this formula here, that zeta s given sigma on the same interval. So we obtain that zeta sigma plus it is not zero for every t, if and only if the dilations of the corresponding function span the L1 zero infinity dx over x. This means that the closure is done in this space. The dilation of what? Of so X S here is sigma plus IT, and so sigma we need added to the function, and so it will be X sigma e to the X plus 1 for all positive lambda. And we can, so it is the same Wiener-Tauberian theorem, and we can, if you want, change the variables here. So if you dislike this invariant measure, so we can go to the usual L1 or LP in general, just multiplying by x to 1/2. And so we obtain that this is the same as said that the span in L1, the arbitrary, the usual L1 d lambda of x sigma minus 1 e x plus 1 for all lambda. And so this is very simple, and we can continue because in principle, all integral representation, at least in the real domain, not on, on the contours in the complex plane, lead to some equivalence with some approximation problem. With exactly same technique, Wiener-Tauberian theorem. And what does it mean? We will see, in fact, that as for Wiener-Tauberian theorem itself, one of these arrows is trivial or almost trivial, and another is not. And so this theorem in particular, it can be useful. So if you use trivial arrow, so no hope to help to your initial problem, the zero of zeta function. So this theorem can be regarded as an attempt to prove the Riemann hypothesis. And all the rest, what started from this point, so will be in the attempt to disprove this, because I will go to a stronger norm, so not L1, but LP and weighted LP with P larger than 1. More complicated family of functions. And so it is can be useful for Riemann hypothesis in the sense of disproof. So to remark that this complicated approximation is not possible, and so there is no this conjecture, this hypothesis. By the way, the use of the word hypothesis is very abusive. It's not hypothesis, it is conjecture, of course. Okay, and so and also so this is some remark. So we will change L1 to LP on the various intervals on R plus with some weights, or LP on 0, 1 simply. And also we will use not, this is the first difference, and the second one is that we will use not the all dilations. So the group of dilations where the Wiener-Tauberian theorem holds, but the semigroup. Semigroup, so say d lambda, lambda bigger than 1. This is the half line in the multiplicative group of positive numbers. And this is the principle. Differences. Yeah. This is some specific point. Okay. I start with the principal integral, yet another integral representation, which will be principal for these links to the dilation completeness problem, which is not stated already. So it is so the principal formula, the key formula, the key formula for the rest is the following. So we consider the fractional part of a real variable on R, so x minus the entire part of x, and consider the function phi, which is equal to 1 over the fractional part of 1 over x. It is not something beautiful, I can say. So if we have, it is something like this, and then something 1/2, 1/3, and so on, and like this picture, and the formula is the following. So given t bigger than 1, 1 over ts minus 1 minus zeta of s s t to the s is equal to integral on 0 to 1 phi tx. What?
T is not the imaginary part of S.
Where is imaginary part?
T in the definition.
Huh? So T and S are not related.
Ah, I'm sorry. Yeah. Okay. Lambda. Lambda. But yeah. It is impossible to fix notation. You know, this is a big problem, especially if it's not a short paper but a book. So all letters are fixed, and you cannot, and you stop in a moment. Okay. So let lambda be bigger than one. Then we have this formula. We can, if we consider F a linear combination of this guy, so AK phi lambda K X, some finite linear combination with lambda K bigger than 1, we can have that the Millin transform, because this is the Millin transform whose definition I read already, of this function f restricted to 0, 1 at the point s is equal to f1, because the formula is linear with respect to this combination, over s minus 1 minus zeta of s over s summation ak lambda k s. Okay. So why it is correct? It is correct by the definition of the fractional part. And by partition of the integral of the interval of integration on the small intervals where this function has this simple definition. So we'll do it. Say not with the all where is it here? Not with all computations, but however, phi lambda x xs dx over x. So changing variable, it is 1 over t to infinity t minus s. This is lambda. You're right. Lambda, and fractional part of x minus s dx over x. So I have a change. I change the variable here. Lambda x is equal is replaced by x, and this gives
one over x.
Yeah, 1 over x. This gives this one. So integration from 1 over lambda to 1 plus the other make differently. This is explicitly because it is equal to here the fractional part is equal to x, and here we consider the intervals to n to n plus 1 where the fractional part is equal to x minus n, and integrate by parts. So I permit me to give this explanations and write the result, and the result will be exactly lambda minus s minus 1 over 1 minus s lambda 1 minus s minus zeta s over s. Okay, and so the last formula, this one is immediate because both parts are linear with respect to these fractional parts. And so now we can derive immediately a corollary, which is derived by Neeman, by when you are expert, so you know the name, in 1950, a student of Berlin who disappeared after, absolutely without any trace, no in high schools, no in university, nowhere. Okay, so he considered the linear hull, the linear hull of this d lambda phi lambda bigger than 1. So this is a half group, the semi-group already. Okay, and a naught, which is functions from a such that f1 is equal to 0. So if f1 is equal to 0, so the function f, because phi lambda x with lambda bigger than 1 and x between 0 and 1 is equal to 1 over lambda x, okay? And so if it is equal to 0 f1 in this point, so it's 0 on the whole interval there. So it is supported, the function from a naught is supported by the interval, by the unit interval from 0 to 1. And let d be the distance in the space L2, the usual L2, from the function 1 to a naught. Then the disk D index, I'm sorry, D and D, but nothing to make the disk D, maybe capital D, which is defined as all complex S such that D square S square is less than two real part of S minus one. This disk does not contain the zeros of zeta function. Does not contain the S with zeta S equal to zero. Why? It is immediate from this formula. Because
S, what's the two real parts of S?
Zeta of S, such that it does not contain the points S, where
no,
zeta...
Definition of disk, two real parts finish. Of S, minus what?
Two real, minus one.
Ah.
Minus one. So it's maybe not so easy that this is the disk, but this is the case, of course, and I can write it explicitly, because it is there is a little practical interest, maybe, in this very simple, easy corollary, which shows once more that the sufficiently part of this criteria, which I will state, so it is very difficult to apply. So, in particular, and not finish the corollary, in particular, d equal to zero, so if one belongs to this closure, it implies that there is no zeros of zeta function on the real part of S bigger than 1/2. And zeta s is not zero. So the Riemann hypothesis, because as you know, as an expert, so that the in view of the functional equation, the zeros of zeta function are symmetric with respect to the line real part of s equal to 1/2. It is just if they exist, or they are all on the critical line. So, if this approximation is possible, there is no. Why? Because it is this disk, in this case, it is just the half plane, the infinite radius. And in principle, this disk is what it is. It is sigma minus 1 over d square, where is the center and the radius, plus t square, so the real and imaginary part, less than r square, which is by definition 1 over d square, 1 over d square minus 1. So the computation show this one, and so this is the disk centered in real point 1 over d square and the radius r. Okay? So something, so d is at least less or equal than 1. It is clear because the norm of this function is equal to 1. And so we have the center of this disk somewhere here. And so some radius, which is bigger, the radius is bigger than the distance to 1. It can be checked, it's easy from this definition. It is bigger than 1 over d square minus 1. And so we have some disk like this, whose radius grow when d tends to 0. If d tends to zero, so the radius and it approach the line of 1/2, exhausting this region. Okay, what is it? It is just from this formula which is here, because if we apply this formula to the function 1 minus f, in order to compute the distance, 1 minus f, not 2f, but 1 minus f, where f is in this set A naught. So we apply this formula 1 minus f. So we take f from A naught, and we suppose that zeta s is equal to 0. And it gives so x s minus 1 dx, and so by the formula, what happens? Where is the formula? It is here. So where is it?
So
we apply it not to the fractional part, but to f. And so we will have in the right hand plus lambda minus s f1 over s minus 1 lambda 1 minus s minus zeta of s over s. And so, and the both terms are equal to 0. This one because f belongs to a naught, and this one by our hypothesis that it is also 0. And so this this integral with f is equal to 0, and it's still integral of x which is equal to 1 over s. And so we obtain that 1 over s is less or equal than integral of the 1 minus f x s minus 1 dx, and applying just Cauchy inequality, we obtain what we want. So 1 minus f in L2, 0, 1, and 2 real part of s minus 1 minus 1 half. And because the norm, and this is exactly our inequality. So it means that s does not belong to our disk. It means that this is an opposite inequality. S does not belong to our disk DD. Okay, and so there is no zeros in the disk. Of course, you can modify this very simple remark that you can, if you suppose that the real part of S bigger than 1 over P with some P, so you can apply the same inequality with the norms LP, LP prime, the Hölder inequality here, and obtain similar region free of zeros of zeta function, but it will be not the disk. It will be something which is not pleasant, but I can write it if you want. So SP, DP, it is the distance from 1 to the A naught in the norm of LP. P less than P real part minus 1, P minus 1, P minus 1, something like this. So there is no zeros of zeta function here. Of course, the practical value of these consequences is a little bit not founded. But however, the stronger form, which I will show you later on, the stronger form is that we can go up with this disk, and the result will still the same, more or less. And this form, however, is already a little bit competitive, because for this form with the disk who goes upstairs, so I take just t equal to 3 and I compute it on the calculator, not even the computer, and I obtain a better result than the famous estimate of Vinogradov and Korobov of a domain free of zeros of real function. They describe it, the domain here, which with the width which tends to zero here, and so at the level 3 this estimate is better. Simply with better, I don't know, some invisible decimate, but however. Yeah, so...
You can do this only on the fixed level, or you can do this asymptotically.
No, but what I tried myself with my very, very limited capacity, because I does not t equals to 3, I computed all radius and I consider it's better. I cannot cite you, quote you the estimate of Vinogradov and Korobov, but it doesn't matter. Okay, before making a break, which is
as you wish,
ask it,
up to you.
Before making a break, so I'd like to make, however, some philosophical remark, if you want. What happens in principle with the dilations? With the dilations, we can. So some remark on the difference of the group approximation and semi-group approximation, which all people who does approximation know very well. So say they approximate by the translation, by the shifts for all group or only half of group, it's a different matter. And the remark is the following. We can extend our formula to the case of real Millin transform. So what means we can integrate over the whole real line. This is 1 over 2 pi, integral 0, 1, and so on in the formula, but not on the 0, 1. And we will obtain the simpler even thing, just zeta s over s lambda s for always sigma here. And for, say, weighted,
not for all lambda, right?
For lambda bigger than 1, for lambda bigger than 1. And for positive sigma, just positive sigma, we obtain that it is over lambda x of s is equal to minus zeta sigma plus s over sigma plus s. T sigma plus s.
Lambda sigma plus
s. Where lambda here? Yeah. No.
Instead of T.
It persists. It is. I'm sorry. To the contrary to the previous case, so F star, the Millin transform, is the Fourier transform of this multiplicative semigroup. So it is unitary from L2 with respect to this invariant measure to L2 of R, and so we can immediately apply another Wiener theorem, not Tauberian, but even simpler, that the all translations of a function which is in L2 on a group, all translation are complete, so generate the whole space if and only if the Fourier transform is not zero almost everywhere, don't need everywhere. And so we obtain immediately and for free that the all dilations d lambda of this x sigma 1 over lambda x, dilations for positive lambda are complete in L2 of R plus, and we can multiply by x to 1/2 to obtain the usual metric without this factor 1 over x. And so the whole business, what I will enterprise just now after the break, was to replace the group action, this one, which is trivial, to the semi-group action. And this completeness of the same system will be equivalent to the Riemann hypothesis. So the whole Riemann hypothesis is a change of a group approximation by translation with a group by to the translation by a semigroup. So I recall the definition. So this F1, it is simply AK over lambda K. It should be just a linear equation, which is not important, which is just for some convenience here. And the little problem to apply more involved techniques here is that our functions here, 1 over lambda x, it does not belong to A0. And so we need to choose some generators of A0, the most natural as we can. So I will consider the functions psi 2 lambda of x, which is equal to 1 over lambda x minus 1 over lambda, the fractional part of 1 minus x. This is already function from here, and it's very easy to see that the linear hull of psi 2 lambda for lambda bigger than 1, it is equal to A naught. I mean that this linear combination can be represented as a linear combination of psi 2 lambda. I will not take time this linear algebra. And this is the first observation, that we can choose some useful generators of A naught. And the second one, that we of course will apply the Millin transform, so the from L2 on the positive half line dx over x to L2 of IR, and also to its subspace, which is of interest for us. So from 0, 1 to dx over x. And due to Pelli-Wiener theorem, which you can find, for instance, in Tichmann's book, Pelli-Wiener theory, it should be exactly the Hardy space H2 in C+, where C+ in the right-hand half plane. C plus is the S, real part of S, positive. And then, so we have some techniques to use for our approximation problem.
C plus is the upper half plane, lower right or left?
No, no, right. This is for Milnin, this is right. The real part is for the usual when we use the Fourier transform, so it is the inverse Fourier transform. Then you have without star, so L201, it is H2 on the upper half plane here. Okay, and here you have to the right. What else? The important property of the Milnin transform, because this is the Fourier transform, so it commutes with the translation. So the d lambda f star is lambda minus s f star for every lambda. And so we obtain that we will look on the space E, which is the span on L201. I can write, because anyway the functions are equal to zero starting from one of A naught. This is the subspace of L201. Dx over x, which is invariant with respect to dilations, lambda bigger than 1. So making Milnin transform, we obtain that E star, which is equal to F star E, is invariant. It is a subspace of L2IR, which is invariant with respect to characters. So E to the minus a t e star for any positive a. So lambda is one minus lambda, which is here is e to the minus a. Okay, and so we are in the situation of the famous Burling theorem, which we can apply here. And the theorem will give us the following. So if we have the Burling 1949, the famous trick that the invariant subspace of L2 E minus AT on the real line or in this IR, it is not important, of course, to E for every positive A, if and only if E star is of the form theta times H2 of C plus, where theta is in H2 function, which is unimodular on the real line or on this imaginary line on IR. And how to find this? The Burling theorem gave also the rule how to find it. If the space...
Sorry, you want to assume then that E star is a subset of H2, not L2.
H2.
No, but it's in particular L2. Yeah. No. In principle, if I not suppose that theta is in H2, the result is true even for arbitrary, but locally you are right, say H2, so it is better in this case. I can guarantee that theta is in H2.
H infinity, because
it's not square summable.
It's not square summable on the unbounded domain.
Right, yeah. Okay. H infinity, so the H infinity of C plus the bounded holomorphic functions. You're right, this is automatic of the disk thinking. So the bounded holomorphic functions on the z half plane, and how to compute it if E is the span of some family of functions, as in our case F star phi to lambda bigger than 1. So the theta, the functions F star phi to lambda belongs to H2 of C plus, because they are in L2 on 0, 1, and the Millin transform goes to the Hardy subspace. And so I did not define the Hardy spaces, but there was no question, so it's all people know it, of course. So if not, you can look in some, because of course as a prerequisite, I consider the standard harmonic analysis and standard complex variables, including the elementary Hardy classes. Okay. If not, it's impossible to speak. So this is here, and it can be factorized in the standard way for Hardy spaces, the Blaschke product, the singular inner function and the outer part, and the theta would be b lambda, s lambda, f lambda, and this theta will be the greatest common divisor of the family b lambda, s lambda. So simply it will be B of S, where B is the Blaschke product with respect to the joint, this is the symmetric point, SK is here, and S star is the symmetric point on the left half plane, and S is the greatest common divisor of the singular parts of S. So I will not give the definition because I don't need it. In our case, it will be one by and so okay. So we can continue now. So and state the theorem proved by Neeman. All is prepared already. That if we define psi to lambda as before, then the function one belongs to the span of L2. Maybe not one. The function. Maybe square root of x should be. It should be square root of x, yes. Of square root of x c to lambda for lambda bigger than 1 in the space L2 0, 1 with respect to invariant measure, so it belongs if and only if.
Measure 1 also should be replaced by square root.
Yes, it's also square root, and this is, yes, one, I can say, yeah. One, so the indicator function, in fact, the interval 0, 1 on the real line. So if and only if zeta s is not 0 for, so the this is exactly the RH, the Riemann hypothesis. And so we can transform, we can divide by the square root of x and pass to the usual L2, and so give also this form that it is span of psi to lambda in L2 0 1, which is also equivalent. Okay, and so I already proved it, the theorem, because I proved that the if with this notation E and E star, so E star is equal to theta H2 of C plus. And I'd like to prove that the Millin transform of 1, which is 1 over S, belongs to this space. But in fact, is 1 belongs, so this span is equal to the whole space, because the dilations of the indicator function 0, 1, this is indicator functions of 0, 1 over lambda, which are complete. So this space is invariant with respect to dilations. So with the function 1, it contains all these functions, and so generates the whole space L2 on 0, 1. Okay, so we need to show that...
repeat once again.
I'd like to say here just a little remark, that this inclusion, this approximation is equivalent to say that this span is equal simply to L2, 0, 1. Because, so in one way it is just tautology, and in the different, it follows from this formula and the fact, easy fact that these indicator functions are complete. So our goal is to prove that theta equal to 1 if and only if zeta s does not vanish for the real part of s bigger than 1 half. And so we can do it. With our computations. So I do not forget this factor x to 1 half, because it makes a very important shift of the argument of Millin transform. And and so we obtain what we obtain. We obtain from our formula that f star x 1 half psi to lambda. This is computed, and this gives just 1 half plus s in the argument of zeta function. So we obtain 1 over square root of 2 pi, 1 over t s minus 1 half. It was s minus 1, but so I added 1 half. So it, and zeta s plus 1 half, s plus 1 half, and lambda s plus 1 half, minus 1 over lambda s minus 1 half plus zeta s plus 1 half over lambda s plus 1 half. And this, so the parenthesis closed.
Your brackets are not fractional part.
No. Here is the fractional part is finished here.
Okay.
Here is no. It is a million transform already. Eh? So it is 1 over square root of 2 pi zeta s plus 1 half s plus 1 half 1 over lambda minus 1 over lambda s plus 1 half. This is our function from H2 of C plus. By the way, it show between other things that zeta divided by s is square summable, which is not at all absolutely easy. I mean on the imaginary part, or on the imaginary axis. And where is our functions? What is of interest to note, first of all, that all members of this formula, all functions, all parts are holomorphic on IR. Zeta by the holomorphic extension. This is obvious, and this is also obvious. So there is no singular part of theta. So theta is equal to b times s. So s can be only the singular function at infinity. It can be only e to the minus a s, where a is. And this a is so-called, so what is the a? A also is given in Bernoulli's theorem. A is the minus infimum, the logarithmic residue of the functions f x 1 half psi 2 lambda, or over lambda. What is the logarithmic residue? Logarithmic residue in our case, so we are in the right-hand half plane here, and so this is logarithmic residue of this function, 2 lambda x 1 half. This is the limit of log f star psi 2 lambda of x of sigma over sigma. So look now on the formula. If sigma tends to sigma tends to plus infinity over the real line. And this is logarithmic residue at infinity. So if sigma tends to infinity, lambda is bigger than 1, it tends to 1 over lambda, a positive number, divided by sigma, it's 0. So zeta, we apply here the usual formula, s is equal to 1 over ns for s real s bigger than 1. So it's clear that s tends to infinity, it tends to 1. And so also this ratio tends to 0. What is still here, it is only this one. But it's also tends to infinity because log s plus 1 half over sigma plus 1 half over sigma also tends to 0. And so all logarithmic residue are 0, and so the singular part of our function is equal to 1. And what is the Blaschke product? The Blaschke product following the description I gave in Burling theorem, this is the greatest common divisor of Blaschke products of the functions of Millin transform of psi to lambda. And what is it? What is so B is the Blaschke product over the all common zeros of F star x 1/2 C to lambda, okay? But where are zeros? Zeros are here. This is the zero of this function, zeta, for S, real part of S bigger than zero, and of this guy. So this one is, the zeros is 1 over lambda S plus 1/2 for lambda bigger than 1, and the no common zeros. Of course, zeros, because it is simply two pi periodic. So the modulus is should be equal to so s is okay. So it's clear. I will not enter in this explanation. No common zeros, and what still is from the formula, so the SK zeros of zeta S plus 1/2 is equal to zero real part of S bigger than zero. And so this is empty if and only if so the E star is equal to H2. What proof, which proves the theorem of Neeman. And what is the commons? The commons is that, first of all, the numerical version of this, like this elementary numerical version with the distance, is also possible here. I will not do it because my time is almost over, and time largely over behind my plan to tell something of interest. And so it exists, it is written, you can find it, say, in my book, which called Hardy Spaces. Okay, so the quantitative version. So some remarks, comments. Comments are the following, so numerical or quantitative version with the distance d, distance of the distance of what? Of x s x what is the notation? It was 1/2, but we can consider different some s naught to the a naught or even to the a. So and then so the so it's simpler. The disk, this one minus S naught star less than 1 minus 2 real parts of S. D yes, d gamma I will denote to the linear part of is free of zeros. So I take the following notation: d gamma, considering modifying the function up to 2 lambda gamma x to the gamma d lambda phi minus 1 over lambda phi. So the weight here with arbitrary gamma and okay, and S naught is also arbitrary. And so this disk, it is on the level of the imaginary part of S naught. S naught is sigma naught plus IT naught. And this is the analog of the disk when sigma naught T naught is equal to zero. And it is also so free of zeros of zeta function. Another remark or comments is that in fact it prepare the passage to the dilation completeness problem. So we can consider not all d lambda psi 2 lambda psi what no all d lambda of 1 over x say, but only for lambda equal to lambda n, which are positive.
What's d gamma stand
for? Here?
D gamma of s and
D gamma, this is the distance of this function to the to the A naught. Okay. Yeah.
Why it depends on S?
I think that S is gamma. S is gamma. I'm sorry. This is gamma. It should be. This is gamma. And No, gamma is, no, I'm sorry. No, gamma is different. So gamma is here in the modified function psi, and this is x naught another parameter, which is here, and it they enter differently. So d gamma is the distance this XS naught to the linear hull of psi 2 lambda gamma, okay? So gamma is here, and then give, and S naught is some supplementary parameter which gives the
become
open S naught, where is it? Okay, I think so, huh?
I think the same. And there is S not Z, or
something wrong here.
S minus S naught.
Something wrong. Okay, so I will look in my book and I will correct it the next time. Huh? So recall me, because something wrong I cannot identify now in which position it is not okay. So maybe better I will have some more comments for 5 minutes, say. Or not? It is okay. So the comments next time, and so as usual, or I don't know. At least for me, the plan's a little bit compressed now, because it is about a half of what I thought to tell you. So I will make some choice from the rest, some comments and results. Which merit to quote, to pass, however, most rapidly to the deletion completeness problem. There is some gap, in fact, because this deletion completeness problem, it is a little bit mysterious. All people in number theory started to regard it from the 1950s. Without any motivations, just it is interesting for number theory. For what? No mentions that it is equivalent, say, to Riemann hypothesis. And all efforts of the last time gave no result. It's very, very close to be equivalent, but however, not at all. But in exchange, there is a technique. There, because you know, if you look for some small device in the dark place where you look under the light, of course, and so this is some thing which can be observed here. So thank you very much. Yeah.